For the second time this summer, it's my pleasure to now introduce Warren Weeks. He's the principal of Weeks Media. He's going to lead us through today's session. We're all very excited for what's in store here today. So Warren, I'm going to pass it over to you.
All right. Thanks very much, Peter. So I'm going to break this down into a series of different areas. Like, what are the pieces of a great presentation as far as I'm concerned? And again, whether it's in person or on something like Zoom, it's how do you prep? How do you include better storytelling? So we're borrowing on a piece from the social media here as well. How do you inject better storytelling into your presentations? Because everybody loves stories. How do you take your visuals game and crank that up a notch? Because I have, like you, I've sat through a number of webinars and meetings online over the last 3-4 months. And I am still amazed at the number of slides of just bullet points where you'll see just text, just 5, 6, 7 lines of text after text after text after text. And then the speaker gets on and just reads the slides to you. And meanwhile, we can all read them in half a second. So how do you inject better visuals to augment your presentation? When it comes to delivery day, how do you make sure that all that work that you've done pays off, and how do you really crush that presentation and knock it out of the park? I'm gonna give you a couple tips for the Q&A element. We're not gonna spend a ton of time on that, but I do wanna cover it because there's one very important strategic element that I'd like to get across. And then a couple pieces of advice for online presentations, because I've done so many of these and I've been watching people and seeing people who do it well and people who don't. And we were actually sharing some stories beforehand about different organizations and how those have gone. So the first component is, how do you prepare like a pro? And to me, this is the piece that you absolutely, it's one of those slides again, the moving slides. I think if anyone's wondering where I'm getting those, it's from Canva, C-A-N-V-A. This is a site that I plugged in my social media talk. You can go on there and download backgrounds like this, and also dynamic images or videos you can put in your presentation, which are like nice small files, but they add a ton, I think. Now, the foundation of your presentation is your prep. And if you don't have a great preparation or a great foundation, it's really difficult to change course and have a great presentation after that. Another thing that I'm going to ask you to do is take a clue or a hint from Hollywood storytelling and start with the end of your presentation instead of the beginning. If you'll notice today, I didn't start out by introducing myself and showing you my LinkedIn profile or my resume or any other work that I've done. You already know who I am. They gave me a nice introduction. And I started by saying that I have one objective today: to give everybody who's here today one tip or technique that's going to make you better at presentations. So that kind of sets the bar and sets the agenda. And then we get to work backwards and fill in those pieces. But many people, when they start a presentation, will start from an old deck that they had. Where the first thing that they'll do is they'll open up PowerPoint or Keynote and start just kind of shoving stuff into it, this brain dump into your slides. Before you do that, I'm going to suggest, and again, this might not work for everybody, but it works for me and it's worked for others. Before you turn on your computer, grab a stack of index cards. You can get them at Staples. They're very inexpensive. You get a stack of 500 of them for like $3 or $4. Get a Sharpie and start writing out ideas. And now what I'll do is write themes or big ideas on that topic on these cards. And then you can see them all, especially for visual people, this really helps. You can see them all on your table. And then you can kind of move them around. You can move the flow, move the order, take one, rip it up, throw it away, add a new one. To me, this element, this like really like pen and paper and just like looking at it, is a really, really important piece to putting those elements together and figuring out that flow. And once I figure that out, and once I figure that I've whittled it down to the tightest that it can be and the leanest that it can be, that's when I'll start my computer and open up PowerPoint. The flip side of that is that, you know, we all love our content so much. And so it's very difficult, but I'd ask you to go in and be ruthless with that delete key. Like, does the audience absolutely need to see this, hear this, learn this? Or is this just fluff and filler? Or am I maybe more attached to this emotionally or intellectually than the audience would be? So I can tell you that in preparation for this presentation, I deleted, I think, between 25 and 30 slides that you won't be seeing today. I think I've got around 65, 67 slides or so, so about 1 a minute. Then as you can see, I'm flipping through some of them, just a couple. They're only on the screen for a couple seconds. Now, one of the things that I ask people, like, why are you nervous about presentations, or why is your confidence low, or why do you have anxiety? Because public speaking is one of people's biggest fears in life. This is, they did a survey one time and they said, of all these different things, what's your biggest fear? And more people said public speaking than they said dying. So Jerry Seinfeld had this great joke. He said, so most people would rather be the person in the coffin than the one giving the eulogy. And so what it comes down to when it comes to a lack of confidence or increased anxiety is a lot of people, they get into the what ifs. What if something goes wrong? What if I forget my line? What if I forget my word? What if the power goes out? What if I get heckled? What if I get a bad question? And so one of the things that I'd like to do to add confidence is to put in, I call them plan Bs and backups. And so I'm going to give you some examples of what those look like. So in a real world situation, if I'm giving a talk in a room or in a conference in a hotel, in a boardroom, these are a couple of things you can do that really tangibly ramp up your confidence. Now, anyone who sat through the social media presentation a couple of months ago, this is a huge story just in communications in general. How do you tell better stories? And so what do I mean by that? Because the story, this is one of those buzzwords. What's your narrative? What's your story? And some people will just kind of like just bolt them on in a kind of an awkward way. And to me, the story has to help prove the point. Another tip I'd like to give you, and this is something that I've tried to do here today, is to take the typical presentation structure that most people use when you see people give a talk. Hi, my name is Ted. Some of you may have known me. I've been here. So they go through who they are, what they're going to talk about, and da-da-da, they get into the nuts and bolts. And then right at the very end, hopefully they get to the motive or the why. And ask you to flip that right around and get rid of the who, right? Like everyone knows who you are. And even if they don't, it probably doesn't matter. Does it matter who I am or where I went to school today for your purposes? Probably not. So we got rid of the who, and I started out with the why. I want to provide you with a tool to become better presenters so you can persuade your audience in a more effective way. And now the how and the what is what we're going through for the rest of the presentation. So again, Hollywood storytelling, but a great storytelling technique to flip things upside down. Start with the why. There's a great 5-minute video by Simon Sinek, S-I-N-E-K, called Start With Why. And he talks about how great companies, and he uses Apple as the example, use that at the core of their marketing. So when it comes to your delivery, you've done all your prep, you've done all that work, you've done all that, you know, working on your slides, working on your visuals. It's actual presentation day. Now, again, this could be in person, could be on Zoom. How do you make sure that you're going to knock it out of the park? Here are a couple tips that I'd like to share with you. First of all, make sure you have a strong start. You don't want to have one of those, can you hear me? Is this thing working? One of those 30-second, because everyone's just like, oh my God, it's another one of those. So make sure you start strong, have some energy. You know, while Peter was doing his introduction, I was over on the side kind of jumping up and down and trying to get my energy going because I'm sitting here in my living room. And so anything you can do to jazz yourself up a little bit is going to be great. Make sure you're working towards the time. I continue to look over at the clock, 1:47. I think we're doing great for finishing on time and having time to wrap up with a couple questions. One of the cardinal sins of a presenter is to go long, to go over your allotted time. Always want to make sure you end strong. I love this image. This is just like the ultimate dunk image. Make sure that you end on a high note. Remember George Costanza from Seinfeld? End on a high note and hopefully leave time to answer a couple of questions, which we should be doing today. When it comes to the question and answer period, the biggest thing I want people to understand is that it's not a separate part of your presentation. Like many people will treat their presentation and they have their messages and they have their content and they have their mandate. And then when the presentation's over, they close that and then they start answering questions about everything willy-nilly. And so I want you to understand that the Q&A period is part two of your presentation. So it's the same messages, the same content, the same threads. You don't just give up on the stuff that you just presented. It's the second version of you. So what you want to make sure is that you don't have someone in the audience hijacking your presentation or bringing up a matter that might be important to them but isn't important to your topic. So you have to be able to be the traffic cop to deal with those. I like to tell people to steer clear of hypothetical questions. When you're answering a hypothetical question, you're making things up, you're speculating. So always try to bring it back to what we know today or what we're doing today if you can. And sometimes repeat questions are trying to kind of poke holes or undermine your argument or your points. And what I like to do is to tell people, look, I think I've answered that question. I'd like to answer it one last time, but my answer is not going to change. My answer is going to be the same. And this is a real big one. A lot of us feel like we need to be subject matter experts all the time. And so one of the most powerful things you can say sometimes is, I don't know. If you get asked a question and you don't know the answer, just tell people, look, I don't have that with me, but if you want to leave your email address, I can get back to you today. Is that okay? It's a really valid and viable thing that you can do. And any chance to wrap up at the end, just reiterate those key points in the Q&A. You're going to have 1 to 2, maybe 3 things. And today, mine are practice and prep and work. And so if you can leave by reiterating those, you're going to be better off. So we'll mention a little bit about online presentations in the land of Zoom. This is a shot of one of the presentations that I had given in March, and it's kind of my setup. So you can see the high definition camera over top of my computer. You can see my spare computer off to the side in case I have a glitch. There's a stand under my computer to lift it up a little bit, and a notepad and all those different elements, and a telephone if I need it. That setup has evolved a little bit over time, but I'd like you to put a little bit more thought into it than just having your computer on your desk and hitting the power button. Obviously the content, all the stuff we talked about today, storytelling, but here's some basic things. Make sure your camera's up nice and high. I'm gonna show you what my setup looks like on the next slide. Make sure there's a light facing you, so I have some natural lights in front of me and a light in my kitchen shining on me as well. Try to squeeze out all those ums and ahs. That's something that I've tried to do today. Make sure your energy level is a little bit higher than usual, because again, that Zoom translation piece, like I'll just jazz it up a little. You've probably noticed I'm talking with my hands a lot. I'm trying to modulate my voice. Those images, short stories, I've had almost 70 slides for a 60-minute presentation. So just making sure we keep things clicking along. And now for the big reveal, this is what I'm looking at. While you're looking at me, this is what I'm looking at. This is not exactly Hollywood status stuff, but I have an ironing board with a laundry basket. That's what my computer is sitting on. And then I've got my printouts of all my materials beside me and a bottle of water and my camera. So it might not look that pretty. I wouldn't necessarily show that to people if we were talking about something else, but because we're talking about presentations, this is the sort of effort that I wanted to put in so that I'm not just sitting at a table that looks like a hostage video. So that's pretty much everything I wanted to cover. Obviously, I could talk about this for hours, but I want to make sure that I respect everybody's time. And so at this point, I will hand over control back to the folks at CIRC and answer any questions that anybody has.
Oui, un grand merci, Warren. J'offre la portion bilingue de la présentation aujourd'hui. So thank you, Warren, very much for joining us today. And c'était formidable. Please, if you can, take one moment before you leave to fill out the exit survey we'll be sharing with you. And we look forward to seeing everyone at our upcoming webinars in a few weeks. So thank you, merci, et bon après-midi.